computer. Okay. I hope yes, I see my recording is working. So, and good morning to everybody. And as usually, here is our quiz. Prove minimax theorem in the way it was done in the lecture. And you can start working. Record is, should be Alt P. Yes, it is working. So our record is resumed. So we are coming, and other participants, please resume your recording, quiz backup recording, yes, and one more. Okay, so, wow, I see that only me is recording now.
I'm also
okay, very good, very good. Thank you very much. Okay, so our lecture today is about minimax. Wow, just a second, hand tool. Okay, about minimax games and Lagrangian duality. It's very interesting. We are coming to really hardcore of optimization. This topic is usually challenging, but I hope that I succeed to bring it in a relatively simple way. So the first thing you already learned and showed that if I have a function of two vector variables, then just let me see. Yes, then if I I minimize in Z and maximize in omega, but I compare different order, which one I do first. It is unusually little bit. What is on the right hand side, what is inside the parentheses, you do first. You first minimize in Z and then maximize in omega. And what we learned, how I try to memorize, if I do the operation first, it works, it has a stronger consequence. If I minimize in Z, then result will remain smaller than all other results. So max mean is smaller than or equal than min max. Any question, any comment for this very, very central statement? Yes.
Yes, I have a question.
Yes.
And video, the right hand side, you denoted as a const at some point, and the left hand side, you say, like at one point, you say the minimum of Z would be bigger than the const, and that I didn't quite.
Okay, so you invite me to come to the ideas of proof.
I don't only the
okay, I don't have proof on my slides, but to make it clear for the listeners, okay, what is the sketch of the proof? We first say that if we minimize in Z, we remove Z from the consideration. We live only with function of omega. And then, of course, this function of omega will be less or equal than the same function for arbitrary Z and given omega. And now the second part, after I maximize it in omega, I am left with number. You're right. I am left with number. And then, so if all this expression is smaller or equal to this expression in parentheses, then this number will be smaller or equal than this function. Expression in parentheses is function of z. Then for any given z, this will be greater or equal than this number. I'm not sure that I'm very clear. If I do minimization, I remain with function of omega. After I do maximization in omega, I leave this number. And try again to formulate your question now.
I got that part, that you have on the right-hand side a number. And okay. In the video, you say this number has to be smaller than max omega on the left-hand side, FZW.
Yes.
And then you say, if I minimize Z, then it's also true.
If what is written here in parentheses, this is a function of Z.
Right.
I say that my function of Z is larger than some number. I should plot something. I have function of Z, some function, okay? And this function is larger than some number C.
Why did you put the C over there and not a little bit higher?
Because it's larger for any Z. If I would put it here, then there will be some Z.
Okay. When I got it.
It is not larger. Okay.
Okay. I got it. Thank you.
Okay. Good. Okay. Let's continue.
I have also a question.
And it's very good that you have become active. This is very challenging stuff. And getting through proof.
I have a question also.
Okay. What is the second question?
So in the video you said there were the stage that you took maximum over omega, right?
Okay, you should say what should I show in the slide.
Okay. You see what I'm doing here?
Just a second, how can I see? You mean your video?
You see what I'm writing on your video?
Okay, yes, very good, yes.
Okay. So, there were a stage where you said FZ omega like this is greater than minimum over Z FZ omega.
Okay.
I have a question.
So the claim is that this statement is true for any given Z.
Yes.
For any given Z, if I fix yes. any given Z, so I remain on the left as a function on omega and on the right on the as the function of omega.
Yes. Yes, I have a question about it. So,
okay.
When you have a function from both sides of the inequality, functions of omega.
Yes.
You mean that every omega you plugged the same omega in the two sides, the same omega you plug in the same side, or
I think I know your question. Let me do some illustration. So we have a function of omega. Yes. I have one function of omega, and I have, and it may even have some minimum, yes? Let's do it more. It may have some minimum, and I have other function of omega, which also may have some minimum even in other place, yes? Let me take better place. Is this pen good enough? Yes. Okay. And the claim we have. What claim do we have? that say this is F1 and this is F2. If for every omega one function is smaller than other, then my claim is that also the minimum will be smaller than this minimum. It may be indifferent. Yes?
Okay.
Did I answer your question?
I need to think about it. Because what I wanted to see, if you will tell me fz omega 1 and dir fz omega 2, which are variables that can change, okay?
I know, it's challenging to understand this formula. But this from graph, you understand. Then if this function is larger than this, then there cannot be situation that minimum of this function is smaller than this minimum, because otherwise it should go, if minimum would be smaller than this, yes? It should intersect somehow. It should have some area where it's smaller than F1.
Okay.
Okay. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you.
Okay. So, and now we can continue to this next. Just a second. Okay, and then we have a game interpretation, which is very important. It opens you another view. So we say we have two players, Z player and Omega player, and one of them may choose the value of Z player, choose the value of variable Z, and Omega player choose the value of omega. As a result, that player will pay this amount to omega player. It's not good game. Yes, that player is always paying something. What do you think? Can be a normal game for formulated as this? My answer is that
I would like to play this game.
Yes, no. My answer is that it's normal game. Why? Because F, I didn't tell you that F is only positive. F may have a positive and negative values. There may be area where F is negative. So it's normal game. It's normal game. And because it is formulated that Z is paying this amount to omega, so naturally it wants to minimize the amount, and omega wants to maximize. And what happens if omega plays the second? Who plays? Just a second. If omega plays the second, then okay, yes. If omega plays the second, he already knows what did that player choose, yes? So he may choose omega that for given Z maximizes this amount. If that player plays first, his mission is more sophisticated than mission of omega player, because he wants to anticipate all possible actions of omega player, and in worst case to be the best. In worst case to be the best. So that player will try to minimize, that player will consider all possible actions, all possible values of Z he may choose. And he knows that for any choice, Omega player will maximize. So Z player will really should evaluate this amount, min max, and put that variable in accordance to this solution of this problem. And if Omega player plays fast, he needs to anticipate what Z player will do. And in this game, in this kind of game, if you play second, you already know situation, you are an easier situation. Then, so the Omega player will gain less if he plays first. And then inequality is in this direction. And this is a response to the way we proved it. Okay, it takes time. I know it takes time and takes an effort to enter it in your head. Please try to ask questions. No, I encourage you to ask questions. Okay.
Can you please explain what is the objective of the game? I didn't understand.
Okay. There are two players and each of them has different objective, because the condition of the game is that Z is paying to Omega this amount. So Z wants to minimize this amount and Omega wants to maximize. And we consider two different situations, when Z plays first or when Omega plays first. Okay?
Okay, and can you explain again what happened if Z plays first?
Okay. If Z plays first, we are here. No. If Z plays first, Omega okay. If Z plays first, we in this situation, when Omega plays second, yes? When Omega plays second, he already knows the choice of Z, yes? And he does the simple thing, he chooses the Omega, which will maximize this. But Z player plays first, so he should anticipate all possible situations. He knows that for every choice of Z, Omega player will maximize this amount. So then Z player should choose the value of Z, which will minimize this maximum. Am I clear?
Yes, got it. Thanks.
Okay, good. Thank you for asking. Because in my experience, it takes several iterations to enter this into the brain. And this is was a really revolution in mathematical and in economics. Yes, Nash equilibrium, it was a revolution in time when it was introduced. Okay. And we told that there is special form of function f when it has a saddle point. If function f is such that it exists a point z star and omega star, and by the way, you understand that z and omega may be vectors. It should not be only scalars. Then if we move in direction omega, we can only decrease the function. Means this point is maximizer in omega. If you choose z equal z star, the saddle point is maximizer in omega. And correspondingly, it minimizer in z. And the example, which I usually give, simple example, when f is equal f of z omega, for simple scalar variables, minus omega squared. I think it was also in the lecture. Yes.
Yeah, it was in the lecture on the video.
Okay. And this is good example of the function which has saddle point. This particular function has saddle, so it looks in this way in z variable, and in opposite way in omega variable. And if such point exists, then min max and max min are equal. So it's very, very good and very important. Okay. Min max equal to maximum. Any question, any comments? Okay. And now, in order to get
a question about?
To get use, yes.
We say that the min max is equals to maximum, right?
Yes, like here, yes.
Do we know the value of it?
The value will be the value in the saddle point. F of z star and omega star will be the value.
Okay.
Will be the value. Okay. And now we will get gradually to it. I suggest you to consider an example of discrete function. Let me do a table with such values, a matrix with values 1, 2, 3. Wait, maybe I will just a second. One, two, three, four, five, six. 7, 8, 9. And I say that I have two variables. I have z variables, which is index in this direction. And I have omega variable, which is index in this direction. So omega may take value of 1, 2, 3. And that belongs to 1, 2, 3. So that says which index I will choose in this direction. Omega says which index I will choose in this direction. And those are function values. Our task now is to find the min max and max min of this function. And how can we proceed? We should, let me see where it's better to write. We should minimize in Z and maximize in omega. I would put it in this way. F, this is my matrix F. I will even put capital F. And Z omega will be two indexes. Z omega will be two indexes. So Z is index 1, 2, or 3, and omega is index 1, 2, 2 or 3. And what I will do, I will do the following auxiliary task. I want to minimize in Z. Let fix omega. Omega will say which row I use. And Z will say which column I use. Let fix omega. and say what will be minimum of FZ omega when omega is 1. What will be minimum in this first row? We should minimize in this this direction we minimize, and in this direction we maximize. What will be minimum in this direction? What will do, will be minimal value of the first row?
1.
And okay, what will be minimum the second row? 4.
Oh.
And here 7.
Yeah.
So for given, for any given omega, I my minimum in Z will be this one. Which omega omega player will choose to maximize his in income? He will choose 7, okay? Let me do it in this way. So omega will choose this row to maximize his outcome. Now, what happens if we minimize in omega first? We get, maximize in omega first. We get here 7, yes? And the maximum of the second column. What is?
8.
And the third?
9.
And that player will choose minimum of those numbers, and minimum will be 7. Again, my question is now, what is written here? Is min max or max min? And correspondingly here.
Min max. Maximum.
Why it's, it is max min?
Because we first took min and then we take max.
Yes, exactly. So here is maximum in omega, minimum. Do you see?
Yeah.
Minimum. Okay, let me put it here. Maximum in omega, minimum z. FZ omega. Okay. And here, opposite. Here I first maximize in omega. And I can put parentheses to remember that what inside of parentheses we do first. And here, of course, I maximize in omega. And maximize in omega and minimize in z. FZ omega. Okay. Some reason I have reflection from my. Okay, nothing to do.
We see it well. Mikhail, can I ask a question?
Just a second. If I will move, do you? Okay. Yes, I am with you.
Just to know what happens if you change the, Z and W. If you change them and search the same way, you will get the same result, right?
You mean if you denote this as omega and this as z?
No. When
you say it doesn't matter.
Yeah, when you say it like this, it's obvious. But in the inequality, you have the inequality is not symmetric. The theorem of minimax inequality is not symmetric, so that's why I'm asking.
It actually is symmetric if you see my pointer, yes, on the slide. So you have function of two variables, and okay, our condition that we denote as z as variable which we minimizing, and omega is as a variable we maximize in. Just a second, please mute your, I should mute microphones. Do we have microphone unmuted? Okay. Again, what, try to ask your question again.
I was just asking if the inequality seems not symmetric. And that's why I asked what happens if you change the variables, the minimum and the maximum, the z and the omega. It seems not symmetric. But if
you say what will happen if I want to maximize in z and minimize in omega, yes?
Yeah, you can see it in another way too. Yeah.
If you will ask about this question, then I will use other notation, I will denote my z as omega tilde and omega as z tilde, and that's all. It's completely.
Your claim is that the theorem is symmetric. It doesn't really matter.
Yes, it is symmetric.
And question also, I think here, you see my pointer?
Okay, yes.
Should it be opposite? Right, like the left side should be z. Star and here omega.
Just second. You want me to do really fast switch? Just second.
I thought that's what he meant when he said that it's a. I think there is a confusion here.
I am afraid we will not be able to go so fast with this. Let's
okay.
After the lecture.
I just want to comment about Eyal's question about the symmetry. Mm-hmm. That the order of the min max. I think that what determines the direction of inequality. Mm-hmm. So if we flip the min and max, then we get a different direction.
Yes. So the inequality says exactly then min max is greater or equal than max min. You don't have to put variables. Yes?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
In max greater than max min, and that's all. Without that,
the second player always wins. That's it.
The second player wins. Yes, in this type of game. Yes, not in all games. I told about all games. In this type of game. Okay, and okay, but let's continue with our example because we didn't finish yet. So we choose when we minimize with this row and maximize with omega this column. Actually, we choose this number as a solution of our problem. And pay attention that this element is a saddle point of our function, because in z it is maximal, yes? Sorry, in omega it's maximal because we maximize in omega, and in this row in z it's minimal. So it's minimal in z and it's maximal in omega. It's exactly what we want from, if you follow my slide, exactly what we want. If we, from this point, if we move to any other omega, mean move here, then we decrease our function. And if we move in any other z, we increase function. So this is the saddle point. And to continue, I will propose you one more example, and you will do it independently in the same way. I just think where to put it. Where should I put it? Okay, you know, I will put it here and move a little bit my camera. I will fill one more table with numbers, and it will be 3, 8, 7. And you can put it on your paper, because this will be our class exercise. 4, 2, 9, and 5, 1, 6. And again, do you, sorry. Do you see what I'm writing? Now you see it, yes?
Yeah.
3, 4, 7, 4, 2, 9, 5, 1, 6. So, and again, this is direction of Z. This is direction of omega. And my task is to find min max and max min of this function. Please do it and show. And like we did. So this is our way to do it, to fill this table. What will be minimal values here? What will be maximum values here? Okay, start working. Start working and tell with voice when you are done. Sorry, light is reflecting. Okay, now it's better. You know what? Let's you have say 2 minutes to work. It's really fast, and 10 minutes for break. And let's continue after the break. In 12 minutes from now.
Okay. I will stop recording.
Yeah. Okay. So we are back from the break. Please respond if you also break. If you're also back.
We're back.
Okay, very good. So, and first of all, there was a remark about the video lecture, and of course, you are right. I just want had 1 minute to concentrate on this. So we say that we have function value on the saddle point, and it is the same as if we fix omega, we should put here omega star, yes? And minimize in z. If you are in the saddle point, saddle point is exactly minimizer in z when omega is omega star. So it should be omega star here and not star here. Yes? That's what you were claiming? Who was talking about this topic?
Katya and Barak was talking, and maybe, yes. Maybe we should change the order of the variables, because
so we should put here z and here omega star, and then if we maximize in omega, we remove index star here, and say that maximum is larger equal than star. Okay.
Just a second, Michael.
Yes.
please see that we always use Z before omega until the point where the so-called claim to be a mistake, where the order of omega and Z has changed.
No, it's not. Sorry. Here are two mistakes. First of all, Z and omega should be in the same places. Z is first argument. Wow, sorry. Z is the first argument and omega is the second argument. And the other thing should be omega star, not Z star, but omega star. Two mistakes in one place.
Well, but if you change the order of Z and omega, then the star is at the right.
Okay, if you put star on the second place, then it's okay. Okay. You're right. You can correct with minimal writing. Okay. And now my question, did anybody solve this problem? I am looking for a volunteer to show it.
Michael, I can share.
Okay, please, I stop my sharing. Stop share. Okay. And you can share your screen.
Just a moment. Here.
Okay, good. You didn't fill the values. It was not easy for you. Okay.
Yes.
You put it in writing here. Okay, so you did it in writing. And, okay, so you got min max and max min the same?
Yes, I think so. Maybe
okay, did anybody get it different?
Yeah, I got the min max is greater than the.
Okay. Let's.
I stopped sharing.
Yes. Okay. Because this was a special example without saddle point, and inequality should be strict.
It depends on what axis you define as.
Okay. Okay. Let's look on example. It's much easier to look an example and then discuss the result. So who is sharing? Okay.
Can you see my screen?
It starts sharing, but not entirely yet.
This is one.
Not yet.
Okay.
It is
okay now. Okay. So, okay, please comment what you did.
Okay, so here is the table 387429516.
When
I want to minimize over the row, I take for each row its minimal value. So for the first row, the minimal value is 3. For the second row, the minimal value is 2, and for the third row, the minimal value is 1. Mm-hmm. I put here.
Yes.
So I do a min first, and after I do a min, I do a max over this vector.
Mm-hmm.
And I put here a 3, which is the maximum of this vector.
Okay. So 3 is min max or max min?
Oh, okay. So 3 is min max. 3 is min max.
I am not sure. Any other opinion about this claim?
Well, I myself have another opinion about this because I got it wrong. I was confused. I do min and then max. So
okay.
It's min. It max min. Because first
we told which was it in what is inside, what is more close to the function, it's mean, it's a first operation.
Yeah, you are right.
So your first operation was close to the function. It was minimization. So you got max min. Okay, we will return to this on the whiteboard once again. Okay, and what was in other direction?
In other direction, first operation is max. So I take the max over each column. The max of the first column is 5. The max of the second column is 8. And the max of the third column is 9.
Okay.
After that, I take the mean of the results. And the mean of 5, 8, 9 is 5.
Okay.
And I put here 5.
And so 5 is max min or min max?
5 is min max. Because the first operation was max, the closer to the function. And the second operation was min. It's the first operation we say the second operation and then the first operation, so it's min max.
Okay, so we conclude then min max is larger than max min for this example.
Yes, that is right.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I will try to return on the whiteboard to what you did now. Let me pin video. Okay. Let me return on the whiteboard. So do you see it well? Yes. So we say that if we minimize in that, we get 3, 2, 1. Yes. And maximum of those 3 will be 3. And if we maximize in omega, we got 5, 8, 9, and minimum is 5. So, and let me circle those 2 points. So, and again, is it min max or max min?
5 is min max.
Min in that max maximum omega f z omega. Okay, and this is max min. Okay, so min max is this value, and max min is this value. Let's check that none of them is saddle point. What is saddle point? If I move in Z, I increase. Second saddle point is minimizer in Z and maximizer in omega. If I move in Z, I increase, yes? But if I move in omega, I don't decrease. So this is not saddle point. And what about 5? If I move in omega, I decrease. So this is maximizer in omega, but it's not minimizer in Z, yes? Because in Z I have larger values. So none of them is saddle point. And in the first example, we did have saddle point. So just looking on the table, if I'm very careful, I can build the table? I can take one column and one row and build them in the way that here this will be minimizer and here maximizer. And doesn't matter with what values I fill others, this will be solution. Actually, I did it in this way. Okay. Any question, any comment? at this moment?
I have a general question, but regarding Minimax, obviously.
No, let's discuss those examples first. If anybody has comments or questions about this examples or claims. Okay.
Maybe it's is it possible to fix a table such that it will have a unique saddle point?
To fix the second table?
Yeah.
Okay, let's think together. What is proposal? For example, if I want 5 to be a saddle point, what should I change in my table?
Maybe you should change the 1.
5 and 3 maybe should not be in the same column.
For example, 1 and 6 can be replaced.
In Omega, it's six okay. In Omega, it's maximizer, yes?
Yeah.
I guess I should change something in this row.
You can switch between 6 and 1.
Switch? Okay, let's try this proposal. Just say, okay, those numbers will be wrong. Where was 6? You want this?
Right? Yeah, that was the proposal, yeah.
Will it help?
I
am not sure that, because I want 5. Here, 5 is a maximizer, yes?
Yeah.
But in that, I want it to be minimizer. If I will put something like
7
here, this will be 7 points.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Let's solve one more problem. Let's solve this. Okay. What will happen with rows? 3, 2, and minimal value here will be 5. Okay, this will help us, yes?
Yes.
And maximal value here will be 8, and here 7,
9,
here 5. And so maximum value in this will be 5. Okay.
Michal, you should replace the 7 by 9, but it's not a...
Just a second.
In the last row.
No, below.
No. You mean here? Not
yeah,
on the table, but here. Okay.
Yeah.
You're right? Okay. So now we get the way to build the table, yes? Put one row and one column. It doesn't matter what you put in other parts of the matrix.
Yeah.
Oh, I should have this. In column, I should have this maximizer, and in row, I should have this to be minimizer. Okay.
You know, I think another important comment here, it's don't must to be a corner. It can be also in,
yes,
in
yes,
the middle.
Yes, thank you very much. It may be in anywhere. Actually, if you move this column, swap between those two columns, the solution will be here. And if afterwards we will swap between those two rows, actually swapping rows and the columns will not change any value, yes?
No, thanks.
Okay, very good. Okay, let's continue. I will share my screen again.
Michal, can I ask one question?
About this example, I'm afraid we should to finish. Okay, if it is very
just,
short.
You just said that it's better to be second player, and we always get like this inequality.
In this type of game, you are more informed when you are second.
Because
yes.
When you prove it in the lecture, you say it's always...
In any game, I was wrong. Yes, thank you very much. And I already told this. I already excused about this. Yes, yes. You're right. Not in any game, but in this type of game. Okay, let's move to the slide. Share. Okay. And now we say that Minimax is very powerful tool to work with Lagrangian, with constraint optimization. Say if we have a constraint optimization problem, and minimum f of x subject to g of x less or equal zero, we write down Lagrangian as a function of x and the Lagrange multipliers lambda, which is written here. Objective plus some Lagrange multipliers multiplied by constraints. And we ask a question, what if we maximize this in lambda? What will happen? And we say that if we are in the feasible area, although in lambda, pay attention, greater or equal zero is a restriction for multipliers for inequality constraints. So if we are in feasible area, constraints are negative, and maximal thing which we can do with positive lambda is to put them zero, and we remain only with objective function, which is written here. But if any of constraints is violated, so it's positive, and I may multiply it by infinitely large lambda and get to infinity. So I get this ideal barrier or ideal penalty aggregate, which infinitely penalizes the infeasible points, but keeps objective infeasible area unchanged. So if I minimize this in x, I get to my solution of my problem. So my optimal function value is min max of Lagrangian. But by minimax theorem, I can switch between min and max and get this inequality. So I can do minimization in other order. So I first minimize in lambda, and I denote this as dual function. Minimum of Lagrangian is lambda, is this in x, sorry. Minimum of Lagrangian in x, this is function which depends on lambda, and I call this dual function, and my problem is to maximize it. Any question, any comment on this?
Is the solution we are looking for, let's say with respect to the value of L of the Lagrangian, is it the F star?
Yes, when x is optimal, we denote f of x star is f star. What was this your question?
Yeah.
Our notation is that f star is solution of our original of value, optimal value of f at x star. It's the solution. Yes.
Okay.
So, and this is just a second. And this is our notation. So we denote minimizer of Lagrangian as dual function, and dual problem is maximize this dual function. And we say that optimal value is larger or equal than this maximum. And of course, there is a notion of strong duality, which when KKT for convex problems, when KKT conditions are satisfied, or when Slater condition, which is much easier to check. Slater condition says that my nonlinear inequality constraints should there should exist a point where inequality constraints are strictly satisfied. Nonlinear inequality constraints. For linear, it even not required. If I have such a point, then strong duality holds. Min max is equal to max min, or in other way, maximal value of dual. Let me maximum value of dual function is equal to optimal value. Okay, and we will do example. Yes, I'm with you.
When you say on the Slater condition, a convex problem, you mean that f and the g functions are convex, right?
Yes, you're right. Convex problem is when the objective and the constraints are convex.
Thank you.
Okay, inequality constraints, by the way. If you have equality constraints, if you have nonlinear equality constraints, the feasible area will never be convex. I should show you examples. This is an important question. Okay. If I have a little set of my constraints, take right up there. And here, for example, g less than zero, and here g larger than zero. And here is g of x equals zero. Okay? Then little set where g, my convex function, is less or equal zero is convex set. But if I want to say that I have equality constraint, mean I want that g should be equal zero, I have this is my feasible set. Only this line. Is this line a convex set? I have a question.
No, because you can take a straight line and it will not be
the same. I can take two points, connect them with straight line, and those points in between will not belong to my curved line. So in my conclusion that gi of x equals zero, equality constraint may be convex only when gi is a linear or affine function, but not nonlinear function. Okay, and we'll do an example now, which is actually very close to what was in the lecture, but let's do it in the class independently, and you will get used. You will get used to this notion of duality. Okay. Assume I have a problem. Let's see where is my whiteboard. Okay, let's put it. Some reflection. Okay. I have a problem. I will even start here. Minimize. Maybe. Okay, I will write here. Minimize 1/2 x transpose x subject to, I would put in this way. I will even do it in this way. Some matrix A multiplied by vector x equal b. Let's try to solve this problem to write down Lagrangian. We will start together and then you will continue yourself. Let's write Lagrangian L of x, y. Instead of lambda, I will put y here. You will see that it's convenient. Can you tell me what will be Lagrangian for this problem?
Yeah, it will be half x transpose
x plus I would write it Y transpose multiplied as a vector, multiplied by my constraints. Yeah. What is constraints? A x minus b. Yes.
Yes.
A x minus b. Do you see it? I hope.
Yes, I can see. I can see.
I will remove the magic. The only thing you will see that for convenience, it's good for me to put here minus to save a bit on minuses in the future. And I say that I always can play with sign here if I have equality constraints, because I have no restriction on sign on the sign of my Lagrange multiplies. I can always say or ax equal minus b equals zero, or minus ax minus b equals zero. So it's convenient for me to write in this way. And now I invite you to minimize Lagrangian in x. So this is this function convex in x?
Yes.
Yes.
Why? Because this is quadratic function. This is convex quadratic function. You can put here diagonal matrix. It's a positive definite matrix. And this function is linear as function of x. Y transpose A is some vector. So if I equate gradient to zero, I will find the minimizer. And our scheme is to find the minimizer to minimize in x. To find the, I would say, even in this way, some x bar is arg. In x L of x y, and then I will say that eta of x is just L x bar y, and I propose you to proceed in this direction. For some reason, I have reflections today from my screen.
Eta of y or eta of x?
Just a second. Yes, you're right. Thank you very much. Of y, of course. And then we will maximize it and find the solution. So I propose you, first of all, to go to these two first lines. Okay, and go ahead, and then we will discuss it. Maybe we will stay a few minutes after. Okay, and I will pause recording. And then we will discuss it. Maybe we will stay a few minutes after. Okay, and I will pause recording. Gradient of Lagrangian, and solve this equation, gradient of x bar y, gradient with respect to x should be equal to zero. I moved my camera, so now less reflection on whiteboard. Everything requires experimentation. Okay. And if anybody is ready, just say it with voice.
I'm ready.
Okay, please share your screen. I will stop my share. Okay, please share your screen.
It is the same world, the document from before, so
okay.
Don't mind the table.
Okay.
This is our problem. We have the Lagrangian, and
yes.
I compute its gradient because I will need to equate it to zero. So the gradient
x minus just second.
Maybe
okay.
Maybe it's the transpose of the gradient. Never mind. We still need to equate it to zero. When I equate it to zero, we get that now I denote by x bar the optimal point is equal to A transpose Y.
Okay, very good, very good. So what is our okay, and now can you write what will be the dual function? Eta of y is n of x bar y, yes?
Would you like me to write it or?
Yes. If you...
So eta of y, it's substituting our solution in
yes.
The Lagrangian. And now I will substitute it. So we have A transpose Y transpose on everything. A transpose Y, it is the first term, the main term, and the constraint is Y transpose A transpose Y minus B.
Okay. And now I think we may simplify because the first term and the second term should have something in common.
They do.
Yes. So,
two times.
What will happen finally?
Okay, finally we have minus half. I take the two of them together. Y transpose A transpose Y. This is the first term, and
yes.
The second term is a scalar product of Y transpose B.
Plus.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much. But hold it on your
screen.
Slide.
Yes.
Keep sharing.
Okay.
Because our next question. So let me write it on the whiteboard to have everything documented. Minus one half y transpose a transpose y. Yes.
Yes.
A transpose y
plus
b transpose y. It's more convenient to say it in this way.
I hope
that you see my whiteboard. And now we should maximize in Y eta of Y. Mean you should write the gradient with respect to I equated to zero, get solution. Let's leave it for other. I know that you will do it. but I want to stop screen sharing.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much, and I will put down my camera.
Okay.
Okay. Move it this way. The whiteboard. And let's continue. So we have this dual objective function. And what do we want? We can find the solution of the dual problem. We can maximize it in Y. And please do it and hold and raise your hand and voice if you finished. Okay, let's wait for a few. Couple minutes, it's pretty fast, I'm afraid. I hope, sorry. Stuff. Just a second. What else we will need for the record? Solution of this. What is X bar? Can you remind me?
Yes.
What is X bar?
X bar equals A transpose Y. A transpose
Y. Okay. It goes from here. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So our mission is now, first of all, to solve this, maximize this dual function, and then we can substitute optimal Y and get optimal X, and solve our entire problem. So. Just try to do those two steps and say when you are ready. And we will get a very nice formula, which is well known, of pseudo-inverse. Actually, our mission, our original mission is to solve underdetermined system of equation in the way, so this system has infinite number of solutions, but we want to find solution with minimal norm. And this is so-called pseudo-inverse. With our work now, we will solve this very classical problem. Okay, just let me know who solved this equation and substituted it to here. Oops. Oops, sorry. This one. So I need to write down gradient of eta, yes? So if anybody ready, just say it with voice, because I don't see now the windows of participants.
Michael, I'm ready, but maybe there is someone else who would like to.
Yes, maybe somebody else. If not, then Let's wait 1 minute more.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sure there are more students that know how to solve this.
Thank you. Thank you very much for being kind.
I personally know a few of them, and we learned about the pseudo inverse. We know how the solution should be.
Yes, yes. Okay, maybe I will do it gradually with your help. We start writing down gradient. So we have this minus quadratic form, yes? So what is gradient of quadratic form? It's just A multiplied by this vector, with this minus, okay? So it, A transpose multiplied by Y with minus. And gradient of B transpose Y, of course, plus B is zero. Because I see that people are quiet, maybe because of this already end of the class. Okay. So what is our solution? Where should I continue? Let me put it here. Let me put it here. So I have y is equal to I have a transpose y equal b. So y is equal a transpose inverse multiplied by b. Okay, and y star, it's optimal. It's optimal y. Are you with me?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So this is our optimal y. And now we just substitute it to the x, which we already had. So we say that we actually want to find saddle point. X is minimizer for every y, but also for optimal y is minimizer. So, and finally we get that x optimal, I will write it here. I just substitute those two formulas, a transpose multiplied by y, and y I have here, a transpose, a transpose inverse multiplied by b. And this is a very famous formula of pseudo inverse of minimal norm solution of this system. The only remark, all this will work. So we equate this gradient to zero. To move from here to here, we need to assume that a transpose is invertible. So this is our only assumption. Okay, any question, any comment at this point? And then we will continue with our usual free conversation for those who want to stay afterwards. Okay, yes, any question, any comments?
Okay. Just to make sure, this problem is called the pseudo inverse problem, yes, to minimize the norm of the solution of the linear equation. Yes.
To find minimal norm, you should multiply right hand side with this expression. This expression is called pseudo inverse of matrix A.
Okay. So this is pseudo inverse under the and the it has the minimal norm.
Yes.
also.
And the property is that this formula provides a minimal norm solution to our equation. Minimal norm solution to undetermined system of equations.
And again, why it's important for us to minimize this norm?
Because see, I have a system of equation which has infinitely many solutions. Yes, you have less equations than unknowns. Why? There are some physical meanings. For example, this will be a solution with minimal energy. If your physical system allows many solutions, you say, what is solution which has minimal energy, for example? There are many meanings of this minimal norm, many possible meanings.
Okay. Okay.
Sorry.
No, this is just last question. And here we had a linear constraint. So our problem is convex, and we could like the min max equal to max min. Yes.
Yes, you're right. Yes, you're right. According to Slater condition, max min equal to min max for this problem. Because it has linear equality constraint, and there is no requirement for no prior requirement to the constraints. If they are linear, the duality is strong.
Because it's linear, it's convex.
Not only because linear is convex, because in Slater condition, I will move it out. I will start erasing parts. Or maybe I will write here. Whiteboard will stay stable. In a Slater condition, if you minimize some f of x subject to gi of x, say less or equal zero. Slater condition says that there should be some point x bar, some arbitrary point x bar, in the way that ji of x bar is strictly less than zero for all non-linear constraints. But for linear constraints, there is no such requirements.
Okay. So according to Slater condition, if all the constraints are linear, it's enough.
Yes.
To have the equality. Okay. Yes.
Thank you. And for non-linear, you should satisfy this. Yeah. Thank you for very good questions.
Thank you.
They're important for other students as well.
Okay. I have a question also.
Yes. We moved gradually to free conversation. So those students who feel they have to go may go, and we are now in free conversation, free questions and answers. I should move a little bit my whiteboard to free some space. Just a second. To put everything except of Slater condition under camera. Okay, I'm with you.
Okay, so the function need to be convex, right? By Slater.
You want to talk about Slater? Okay.
What you explained to her, I didn't fully understand.
First of all, the problem should be convex. What is convex optimization problem in our case? When the objective is convex, and all inequality constraints are with convex functions. So all functions gi are convex, and all nonlinear constraints are only inequality. You cannot have nonlinear equality constraints. So if you have in addition equality constraints, they should be linear or fine.
Okay. So just to summarize, the function need to be convex. If there is equality constraint, they have to be linear.
Just a second. The problem, optimization problem, is convex if, and you continue.
Yeah, if the goal function is convex,
yes.
The equality constraints are linear.
Yes.
And also the inequality constraints are convex, but
are
don't
convex.
Have to be,
maybe linear, have to be linear. Maybe linear and non-linear. Yes. This is
okay,
convex
and,
optimization.
Okay, so if we have this problem, we just need that all the inequality constraints will be smaller than zero, will be negative.
Yes, there will be such a point, x bar, only one point. We need to know somehow one special point. If we found such a special point that all non-convex constraints are strict, inequalities, yes.
Okay.
Convex, not... Inequality, non-linear, convex constraints, yes.
Only the non-linear, yeah. The linear we don't care about.
The linear we don't care, you're right.
Okay, and I didn't understand what promises us that the x, which minimizes the goal function, and the x of the optimal x, okay, mm-hmm. will be the x from the min-max theory.
Tell it again. Sorry.
Okay. What promises us that the optimal x of the problem will be the x from the min max solution?
Okay.
Why you said here in the problem we solved that x star is something, and you say this is the optimal x. Why you derived it from the min max theorem? Okay. Who said it's the optimal x for the problem?
Okay. From strong duality, if we succeeded to maximize our dual function, yes, to solve dual problem, yes?
Okay.
Dual problem is to maximize the dual function, yes? We mm-hmm. should maximize it in y.
Okay.
When you maximize it in y, you get function value which is equal to the optimal value of your original problem. Okay?
Okay. Okay.
But how did you get to the dual problem? You get it by minimization of Lagrangian in X. So if you substitute here Y star, yes?
Okay.
I should start removing star. So I should say that A of AX bar and Y star is equal to F star. This what strong duality promises me. Let me write. Eta of Y star. Okay?
Yes, yes.
I just need to maximize my window because I hope that the recording pin and pin. Okay. I should maximize to keep it for recording. So the L of x bar y is my dual function. When I maximize it, yeah, I get y star. So my value of dual function from this maximizer is f star. So I conclude that my Lagrangian of x bar y star is a solution.
Okay, now I get it.
So if I minimize Lagrangian in x, keeping the multiplies this y star, I get x with the optimal objective function. Okay, good.
Thank you.
Please. It's this topic is very loaded. A lot of new information you get now, and it's good to discuss and ask questions. If anybody is capable to ask more questions, it will be good.
Maybe, but before I want to make a comment.
Yes, okay.
Because yesterday, okay, me and Katya, and also Sapir, that was here in the before the free conversation, we are also taking this semester a course.
Am I recording? I'm not recording. Wow.
Well, no, you're not recording, but both me and Noam are recording.
Okay, it's very good. So I resumed my recording and just put for the record the why. I was not recording for a long time. Sure.
It's okay, it's good that there is backup.
Exactly. Yes. Kind of thank situations. You very much. Thank you very much, and you will upload your video.
Yeah.
Okay. So the point. Okay. Just continue. Yes. So you had discussion yesterday. Yes.
Yes. We were discussing about a pseudo inverse of of doing a filter to an image.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we take an image. We multiply it by the discrete Fourier transform, and then we have some values, some rows which are equal to zero, and the other rows are not equal to zero, and we get an under constrained system of equations, and over that. The solution, the optimal solution that we derive, is exactly the pseudo. The pseudo.
The given by pseudo inverse. So you are very lucky that you got it twice in 2 days, and it's very good. It's very nice. But let's keep it this conversation, which will be valuable also for.
Okay. Us. Okay. It was just a side.
Okay. Yeah. Very good. Very good. I'm very glad that you got it twice in 2 days. So it will get deeper in your memory. Okay. Any other question or comment?
Okay. So I will ask a question here about the duality. It seems like a very powerful tool, the duality, that helps us to move from solving an optimization with respect to x to just solving one variable of the vector of constraints of the multipliers.
Yes, and what is your question? We are lucky that dual problems has analytic solution. It on not always so, but still it may be useful to have a dual problem in front of your eyes, or even solve numerically dual problem instead of primal, or have some estimates of solution of dual problem, like lower bound for your primal solution, because dual problem, any feasible point of dual problem gives you lower bound for this solution of the primal one. Yes, so. This was exactly. Your comment, or you have
So the question is, where or what are the applications? Where do we usually can benefit from doing the dual transformation?
Okay, so I told you roughly. So it even used there are even methods. There are primal dual numerical optimization methods, which benefit from two formulations of the problems. I am not sure that I can add more at this point, unfortunately.
Okay.
So we are done. Or any other question or comment? Okay, so thank you very much, and please, two of you who kept recording, please upload, because I see that it may be needed today.
Yeah, we will do. Thank you, Mikhail, and
thank you very much.
Week.
Thanks, bye.
Bye-bye.